This is a project I'm working on for a client that it's a handmade slingshot, a custom slingshot that he wants to have some on the front of it. He wants to put a fish scale, and I'm going to kind of show you how I do fish scale. It's time consuming, but a lot of fun. Because what you finally get back is when you're finished is really a nice look, and it's got a good solid grip. So I'm going to go through the steps I do to do a fish scale. Same steps you're going to use every time you use it. Doesn't matter if you're working on a gun stock or any type of, let's say for a walking stick, whatever you want to do, the same steps. I may do it slightly different than some other folks out there do a fish scale, but it works for me, and I'm going to show you how I do it. You can see a little closer here. What I'm going to do for starters is I take a small, I believe the number is a 7611. It's just a tiny pointed carbide finishing bit, and what I do is I cut all the lines around the fish scale first. Many people don't, but I do because I think it sets up my carving better. So I'm going to start that, and then we'll move on to the next steps. You got to be exacting. You can't mess around. You got to make sure you follow them. Don't go too deep. This is a little tricky because this has some kind of interesting grain that you got to cut through, so you got to go slow. But that's why it's even more important. You don't have to go too deep. Maybe a quarter of the length of the depth of the cutting burr. But you can kind of see how I'm doing it there. I'm just taking, just doing the lines. And this is going to solidify the shape of each one of these scales. So you want to try and make sure that you're following as best on or just outside the lines. You don't want to cut inside the line. Pardon me. If you cut inside the line, you're going to make the scale smaller. So you want to try and do it so you get them uniform. And most importantly, have fun while you're doing it. You're not doing this for work, you're doing this because you enjoy it. Now for anybody out there that has never done this and worked with a power, has interest in what I'm doing as far as using a power power carver like this, and you wanted to find out how to do it, where to get the equipment, don't hesitate to contact me at Lance@LanceLarsonStudio.com, and I can send you an email back with the company that I got mine from, just so you can take a, nothing else, you can go to their website, you can kind of take a look and look and see if it's something you'd be interested in. Right along the top here, I've got two, because of the slingshot, I've got two grains. The grains, you can see the grain on this. It's from the crotch of a limb, so that it meets in the center here. So I've got kind of curving grains underneath right here. So it's a little tricky. You really have to go slow and make sure you're cutting it correctly. As I go down, it's going to get a little bit easier to outline them because I'm not going to be fighting these grains. But initially, with any wood, another thing that you're going to run into is kind of a problem, is you can run into area where there's the grains converge and knots, because they are much harder. Doesn't matter what wood you're working with, the wood's harder around the knot. So that's the reason this power carver works so doggone well, because it's cutting at a 250,000 RPMs or more per minute, and that allows it to cut so much smoother. You can kind of see what I've got so far. Let me see if I can get a little closer in on that. You can kind of see how I'm outlining them there.
Okay.
Just kind of get a little... Now, these aren't going to be real deep, but you can see that when I'm doing this, it's giving me a general outline so that I can come back and I can shape each individual scale. Now I'm going to go through all the outlining here and then I'm going to come back and show you the next steps for doing the Fishscale on this custom slingshot. Okay, I am down to the last couple of Fishscales. I'm going to finish that off. And also you want to make your little half scales in there. You know, some of the scales, when you're cutting it around in a pattern, they're going to be cut in half. So you're definitely going to make sure you do all of them, all the way up to the edge of wherever you're going to carve. Even if they're just little lines, just little touches, just it gives you a better idea for filling in everything. So that's the whole key to doing these lines, is so you know where you're at. That you got those pressed down. Hoping you can see this. This is a rounded piece right here, so it's a little tricky. And that's all there is to it for that part of it. Now, I'm just going to be scraping off these all the pattern here. It takes a little time because now you've got each individual one stuck. Just kind of scratch them. And I kind of use my thumbnail just to kind of pull them all off. And once I've got those off, you'll be able to see what I've got to work with. And basically, I've put the pattern for everything right there. And now I can work on each individual scale. Now each individual scale has about four or five steps. When I say four or five, sometimes you gotta come back for shaping a couple of times just to get it the way you want it to do it. When you're doing a fish scale, you gotta make sure that you are, I guess the most important thing is you're doing it so they're all looking the same. Same depth, same basic shape. At first it looks kind of weird, you know, it doesn't quite come off with the way you'd hope it would. You know, you say, hey, oh, that's not going to work, but as you do each step it looks better and better. And doesn't matter if you've been doing it a long time or you're doing it the first time, you kind of wonder, is this going to come out right? And then it does. So what you're looking at right there, you can see all the lines that I've got in there. So now I'm able to work with that and I'm able to carve each one individually. So what I use to carve them all individually is I do use a, it's called a small football shaped burr. And I'm going to do a few for you right now for the starting cut so you can see what I'm doing, okay, and how I do it. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to just do a couple toward the top, and just so you can see where we're at, and then I'll come back and we'll look at it a little bit more as we go along. But let's see if I can get this in a little bit so you can see it better. Go. I'm just going to start right here. I put the point of the football, and you can kind of see the shape of that. I put the point right into the point of one of the scales. Push down, pull out, and just kind of sweep back and forth. Not too deep, but just kind of sweep back and forth. So I put it in, and I just sweep back and forth. It's a good idea to get some sort of system. And when I say some sort of system, just go from, either go one across or up one line, just so you're doing it kind of in a step-by-step, so you can kind of get your hand in the same shape, same position each time. Now, you don't want to jump out past where your outline is for each scale. I hope you can see that. You want to leave that because you're going to make that a little bit smoother as you go along with each step. But first, the first step here is just going to be shaping each individual scale. I'm going to bring this back so you can, I don't block it completely from you. And I'm going to lift it up a little bit just so I can get the right angle on this. And you're going to find if you do the same thing. You're going to move it. Whatever you're working, move it to a comfortable place. Move it around comfortably. Don't just kind of work where it's at. Unless you're in a real odd spot, you don't have a choice. Try to move it to a place that is going to be comfortable for you. So you put it into the point of the scale and bring it back and sweep it out. So you're making a smooth indentation all the way through. And along, as you're going along, it's a good idea to get some sort of little brush, you know, to use a toothbrush or whatever you have, just to get stuff out of, get any of the dust out of there, so you can see where you're at. Make sure each one is done correctly. Because depending on the wood, sometimes the dust is kind of sticky and it stays right there, or right where you're cutting it, like this does. Sometimes it's a situation where you've got finish on it and that finish causes it to stay. So you want to make sure you've got your area that you're carving cleaned off. Now, there's going to be half scales all the way around the edge. Don't go to those yet. Do the full scales in the center first and then come back. Half scales are a little trickier, so let's get the whole outline, the whole interior of it done first. And then we'll come back. Sweep the other, smooth it out. Just get a system, and it starts going quite quickly. Point in, sweep to one side, sweep to the other, smooth it out. See if I can get a little better shot of that so you can see what I'm doing. Point in there. To one side, sweep to the other side, smooth it out. Point in, sweep to one side, sweep to the other side, smooth it out. So it's repetitious, and a lot of times that can be some of the toughest type of carving, but you know, it's really nice when you get it done. So do not try to push yourself too far. Hey, if you get tired, your eyes get tired, take a break. It's not, no problem. You're doing this for fun, not to try to work and strain yourself, because your eyes are, since you gotta have these pretty much all the same, if you're straining your eyes, all of a sudden you're gonna have some problems, okay? So make sure that you are not pushing yourself. Take 5-10 minutes, take a half hour, whatever works for you, you know, and make sure that you're getting, you can see what you're doing without much problem. Side, just working my way down. for those of you that have just found this and had never seen power carving, this is a, well, some people call it a paragraver. It is a just like a dentist's drill. It uses the same type of bits that a dentist would use in a lot of ways. They're a little diamond tip. This is a diamond tip football, diamond impregnated. And it turns at a very, very fast RPM, but it, unlike a dentist drill, it's straight. Okay, and this is what causes you to be able to, with the high speed, causes you to be able to do such detail. I mean, there is definitely detail you could never do with anything like, say, a Dremel. Not that there's not a place for a Dremel for some kind of carvings and work, but a real intricate detail carving, there's nothing like one of these little power carvers. And there's so many things you can do. You cannot do, there's nothing that can give you the ability to do so much detail, fine detail, as one of these. And you never know. I mean, you can have a situation where you might think it's a good hobby and start it out, and all of a sudden you start liking it so much, people start coming up to you, and don't be surprised. Hey, can you do this for me? Can you carve this on my knife handle? Can you carve this on, you know, whatever? And all of a sudden, your hobby can become a profitable hobby. You know, just, it may be just something you do for friends, but it also may come, there's many people that have started doing things like this, and all of a sudden, it becomes a business. I got it started as a hobby, and it grew into something I didn't expect, but hey, it's kind of wonderful when you get to be able to do what you love and get paid for it. Not everybody will do it, but hey, that option is always there. Well, you get the general idea, and I'm going to I'll pause this right now, and we'll come back when we get to the next steps, okay? Okay, as you can see, I've completed the first step all the way through this. And now what we've got to do is we've got to separate the individual scales. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm just taking base bit. It's very, very tiny. It's called a 699. It's just a small cylinder bit that I'm going to just sweep around the edge of each individual scale, just around the edge to cut and separate the big round edge of each scale from the scales below it. So I'll do a few of those and show you what I'm talking about. To go deep, but you do want to just do a system, just go across a line all the way across, and you want to just cut down through, and you just want to cut around the outside, not into the scale itself, the round top, but just the outside of it, so that you're separating that scale from the scale below it. So just a quick little sweeping motion all the way through. And by doing that, you're able to separate these out so that we can get to the next step to really differentiate the scales from the rest of each other. And the whole idea is to make it look like all individual scales. So I'm just going to go around each one. It's not all the way around, it's just where they're connecting. Just where they're connecting. And you try to do it as close to 90 degrees to the scale as possible. So I'm going to go through a lot of that. It's really tough to see. I'll pull this back a little bit and you can see it even a little bit better. Get your work at an angle that's good for you. Not try to work in an uncomfortable angle, or you'll make a make a cut that's not going to work for you. And just go all the way through with this, all the way, with each one of these scales, all the way through your entire carving. This is the next step. This is a very important step, so you just got to make sure you spend the time. You're trying to make all your scales exactly the same, as close to the same as possible. So make sure you're making those curves along the outside all the way through. Redundant to look at, so I'm going to pause this and show you what it looks like after we're done with this step. Okay, I'm going to see if I can get this a little closer so you can start to see that now what's happened is it kind of, those little cuts kind of separated out and made the individual scales start to pop. Now, the next step we're going to be doing is at the point of each of those scales, you got to make sure there's no wood there. We want to go a little bit deeper so it looks like it's going underneath the scale that's directly in front of it. So what we're going to use is a small point. What I have is just a little pointed diamond piece. It's just one that I can go into and get a little deeper in, and I can just go in and I guess more than anything just separate it out even more. This is all just making these individual pieces separate. Now, as you can see right now, this is just a little diamond tipped one, very tiny, and all I'm going to do is I'm going to go individually in between each one of these scales at the point of each scale and just make it deeper, just to differentiate, just to separate it out even more. Show you. It's going to almost look like there's a little point on each one when I do this. Because we're going to go back again. See how I'm just separating them even more. But we're going to go back again and shape each individual one of these. But you want to make sure that what this move does is separates the scales side by side. The other move is separated the scales from each row, from the row behind it. This one separates each individual scale. You may find one you missed. Just got to go through. So what we're doing is we're going through and separating each individual scale. And once again, try to find a system to this, okay? Try to find a system so you don't miss anything. When I was trying to show you up top here, it looks like I missed a couple of them just because I was working at a kind of a strange angle so you could see it from this camera. But when I'm on this side here, you can't see what I'm doing when I'm going over here, but when I get to this side, hopefully you can see that I'm separating out each individual scale. This is one little stroke of the burr. Okay, I'm going to go through with all of that. Just keep going here, and you can kind of see what I'm doing. So another one I'd missed here. So I got it kind of separated from the top row. That's what happens sometimes if you're just not doing it. If your system is not working perfect, if you somehow skip a row, don't worry about it. You'll come back. You'll get it next time around. It just takes some time to get through it. This is one of the most, tedious is a way of putting it, but that makes it sound like it's not fun to do. But I mean, it's so time-consuming because there are so many steps in this particular
type of carving that you really got to spend the time to make sure you're touching, making every step on every single scale. Once we get this one done, it's just going to be going through and reshaping everything, and you're going to see that all of a sudden it's going to get real close to being looking like it's a completed piece. It's just going to kind of surprise you how it starts to pop, and I'll come back and I'll show you that. Okay, as you can probably see now, it started to separate out. You can see that it's the separation is starting to really pop, okay, with each one of those. Now you'll notice how when I went in between each one of these, it kind of separated from the front to the back, while the with the first cut, but this one separates that cut that in between at the point separates from this to this, so it starts separating the scales completely. Now what I'm going to do is, you may have some high spots between two, right over the top of where you cut. And what I'm going to do here is I am going to sweep with this football, just sweep a little bit just to lower any high spots between, say for example, here, here and here, just across here, across the little area in the front, at the tip of one of these scales, I'm gonna just run a football over there just to sweep to lower it a little bit, just to make sure that everything from here is going under, you know, so all these are going under the scales in front of them. And that'll just take a few minutes. You don't go deep, you just make sure they're a little lower than the scale in front of them. Once again, just make sure, just sweeping a little bit, just make sure you're doing all of them, okay? Touch all the way through, get a system. If it's back and forth, if it's going at an angle this way, it doesn't matter. Whatever angle works for you, but just make sure you're touching all of them. And that's including on the area, on the edge of your cut area. Because you want these to be, you know, obviously these are cut in, so you want the edge of your border to be down too. Kind of a high cut, you're not trying to take a lot, you're just trying to, when I say high cut, I'm not holding it way down like this, I'm holding it a little higher, at a higher angle. Just like light here, just shows you a little bit more. Slightly, so you can see it here. Okay. Hopefully, the shadow isn't in here, but I'm just trying to sweep. Okay, what I've done now, as you can probably see toward the top of this, is that I started to smooth out individual scales. Okay, and I used the same round football. And all I'm doing is going in very lightly. I am working them this in to the point, and I'm just shaving back and forth, just smoothing out each individual scale. That's what you've got to do here. You're trying to make them even along the edge here, along, just make that arc smooth. You're trying to smooth it all the way to the edge of the scale, just smoothing it. So you're going to go in just like you initially did the scale, where you poked in and swept both sides and then opened it up and smoothed it out. Well, this time you're really doing a fine finish. So you're trying to get it all the way to the edge, and then you go back and you just keep working your way down slowly and surely. I'm going to show you how I'm doing that. So you can take a look and watch, see if I can get this so it's close enough so you can see it, but yet I can just go in for you. Okay.
going back and smoothing it, and you're taking any of the blackness off that may have been a slight burn with any other point. You know, if you're pushing real hard and you got a little burn on it, well, you're kind of burnishing each one of these individually.
You do a few of these,
and so you can see. On some of these, you may have, when we initially separated them out with that little pointed diamond, we may have made a little black mark in the point, so you want to take that out, make it a little deeper so we get rid of that. And make sure you burnish all the way out to both, and sweeping both ways, so you're making a full scale out of it. Edge. Ones on the edge you got to be careful with, but just keep going slowly and make sure you spend time on each one so you get it the way you want it. It's important that you make each one individual as close to the same as possible. They're not going to be exact, just like not every fish scale on a fish is going to be exact, but you want it to be close. What I find works well when I'm doing this final burnishing is going down
a row
this way to finish them off. It just seems to work well for me. You'll find a way that works well for you as you do it. And since this is kind of repetitious work, if you get tired, don't push yourself. Stop. There's no point, because if you... This is pretty exacting work, and you don't want to get it so you end up making mistakes. So, you know, take breaks. The final product will be enough that you'll be happy enough. If you do take breaks, you're going to be much happier with the final product, I guess is what I'm saying. If you push it, you may make some mistakes. Now, this is a small area. I've done this on an area 4 or 5 times as big, and it takes a long time to do. So just remember that you're not going to be able to do any of these steps completely all in one sitting. So this is the type of work that when you do it, it's going to take probably longer than most any other type of work you're going to do in carving. So if you're, just remember that if somebody decides they want you to do this for them, make sure do a lot of practice of this so you know how long it takes. So if you tell them it's going to be done in a couple days, hey, it's probably not going to be done in a couple days. This video was done over the course of a little while, so I didn't just sit down and do it, because there's no way I'm going to sit down and do this all in one sitting, just because my eyes couldn't handle that kind of detail. So that gives you an idea where I'm at so far, and I'm going to be right now, you should be able to see the difference if I just make it a little closer. Be able to see the difference between the two scales now that I've started to do the final burnishing of them. It's kind of an interesting differentiation. When we started, you look at it and it just looked like it would never come out, but that's what all these individual steps do. They just allow you to look at this and get it so it slowly doing each step, it brings these scales more and more into definition. Before you know it, this is going to look great, because once I get it all done, I'm going to
what we do is we take, I take a Scotch-Brite pad, okay? Just like this rough Scotch-Brite pad. And what I'll do on that area is I'll just go over the top of it. Blow the thing out and just kind of go over the top of it. And it evens up the top edge of all the scales. Okay, I'll blow the excess out and I'll go over it again. It's like I said, this is a rough Scotch-Brite pad. This isn't something like you're going to find in the, and they go by color, but it isn't going to be the kind of like you're going to find in a kitchen area. Although, because that's a little, well, it's not as coarse as this. But you can use any of them. But I just tend, this color is more like a sandpaper. You know, I would guess if it's more like a 220 sandpaper if I was going to compare it to anything else. And it, what it does is just give, just smooth off the top. It gives it a little edge. I mean, takes off the little edge. So that is where I'm at right now. And you can maybe see, looks like, now you might be able to see this, and you'll see it even more once we do a finish on it, is you're going to be able to see the grain right through the individual fish scale. It's going to look really cool. And I'm going to finish this off now, and I'll come back to it when I've got it complete and we're ready to do some final sanding on everything. I shouldn't say sanding, but buffing with the Scotch-Brite, and we'll be ready for finish. Okay, let's take a look at it. What we got here is completed. I did run the Scotch-Brite, and I also took some 220 sandpaper and just kind of really lightly just ran over the top of each individual scale just to take off any edge. Nothing, I'm not pushing hard, I'm pulling through. I'm not going back and forth on it, just one straight light pull through, just so I could feel and see if there's anything, anything at all. So it, just I want to be able to see if there's anything that's going to stick out and cause a little bit of roughness there. And I saw, felt something right there, so I'm just going to go across it a couple times. That made all the difference. A couple right there. Makes all the difference. I just want this to be smooth so someone can pick this up and not have a problem. All right, it's got to just feel good. Now, if we got a little closer on this, you can see, looks like there's some difference in coloration. That's because there's some difference in the coloration in the grain. It's going to pop out a little bit more when I put a coating on it, and I'm going to do that next, and then I'll show you what it looks like with a coat, the first coat of finish. Well, I finished up the shaping, the final shaping of all the different scales, and I have put on two coats of True Oil, and that's something I use in gun stocks and all different types of wood. It's a real nice oil finish, just so you might want to look into that if you want to use it on any anything for a real nice natural finish. I've been using that for gun stocks for years. You can find it lots of places. So, but as you can see, it seems a little lighter down here than it does up here, and that's just because it's the wood is lighter there. So you can, if you move it back and forth in the light, you can see some of the different grains in it. And if I put it up a little closer, get you a little better look at it, should come in here pretty quick. So that's what I've finished for this Slingshot, and hopefully this is something that piqued your interest a little bit. Go back over the steps there and give it a try. See if it's something that you enjoy doing. Like I said, it there's a lot of steps to it, but it really looks nice when it's finished. Thanks a lot for tuning in. Until next time, this is Lance at Lance Larson Studio. You have a great day.